So nice to be joined by these fabulous ladies who are also friends. So I'm Nikki Hall, CMO of Contentsquare, and let me try to guess who's who with the fun facts. So I would have to say you're probably the opera singer, and you played chess with the prime minister.
I can definitely not sing.
So. Yes, I can definitely not sing, so it has to be the other one.
Ooh, Sehr. Can you do a little something for us? Please? Pretty please? Come on.
Maybe we'll add it in.
Oh, good.
To this conversation.
And maybe that will be the social. Remember, you guys, if you post social, you get these cool kicks, these
cool
trainers. I actually had a different pair of shoes I was going to wear today, and then my team gave me these. They're personalized. And I think the team's going to personalize them for you, too. So make sure you're engaged in social. And it should be maybe when you're doing opera.
And I'm going to the Met tonight, so maybe you'll be there as well.
I wish.
Okay, well, welcome to the Decade of Digital Disruption panel discussion. Today, we're going to dive into the wild world of tech and how it's been turning our lives upside down, in a good way, we hope, for the past 10 years. Think about it. From the rise of smartphones, social media, artificial intelligence, now Gen AI, and streaming services, the digital landscape has transformed faster than we can binge watch a season of our favorite show. And for me, it's probably Suits. What's your favorite show?
Ted Lasso.
Oh, yes, yes, yes. And what about yours?
Oh, gosh, I haven't watched TV in a while, but it used to be Grey's Anatomy.
Oh, yeah. Or Ozark, right? That's another good one. It's like we blinked and suddenly everything's smart. Our phones, our homes, and even shopping. So what does this all have to do with digital disruption? That's what we're here to uncover. We got a rock star lineup, as you can see. We'll get some singing out of this. We're going to talk about the highs and lows and jaw-dropping moments of the last decade in tech. So sit back, relax, and get ready to ride the digital wave with us as we explore the decade of digital disruption. So we're going to start with a Slido. I think they're going to put a Slido up there. And so get your phones out, engage. And what do you guys think has been the biggest digital disruption you've experienced over the past year? And while you're doing that, let me ask the two of you. Denise, what has been the digital disruption, the biggest one for you?
Is there only two letters in the alphabet these days?
I know.
Right? I think, again, of course, AI has been the biggest, you know, disruption. But I think really the biggest is more the speed of disruption. And I think, I mean, Silicon Valley has never experienced this type of speed and pace of disruption before. So I think that's really the biggest challenge we're faced with. Everything is moving so fast. How are we going to keep up? I think that's everyone is worried about. We know that the technology here is here, but how do we keep up with things? It's really a race of the fastest.
Great, thank you.
I agree. Generative AI is everywhere. But I think we're seeing also, you know, coming out of COVID and all of the digital, you know, everything, digital connection, everything is really how do you connect from a human perspective with all this digital disruption and keeping up, to your point, Denise, with the pace of change. It's just inevitable.
Yeah, absolutely. Let's see what the word cloud brings out? Or they will pull it up, and then we'll move to the next question as they're pulling it up. Okay, so how are you and your businesses embracing disruptive technology? So you talk about the speed of disruption, you talked about AI, you talked about Silicon Valley. I think of the internet, cloud, et cetera. Oh, here it is. Biggest disruption you've experienced over the past year. So, yep, everyone's saying Gen AI.
Maybe we should all sing AI.
But that's not up on the screen. Soon it will come. Oh, there it is. CX Oracle, cookieless, hacking, accessibility, privacy, AR, VR, AR, yep. Pay by phone by subway, absolutely. Which is so nice, right? When you're in London and you're riding the tube, you just tap your phone now. I wish they would do that in Paris. They haven't done that in Paris yet. But they need to do that in Paris. Okay, great. So why don't we go to you, Denise? How are you and your business embracing disruptive technology? So you're at Snowflake, chief marketing officer at Snowflake, took them through their IPO. I'm sure you had a lot of tech you were dealing with then.
I think, first of all, I mean, you cannot deal with this from a fear perspective. You really need to deal with this from a curiosity standpoint. And it's the media so much is so much about the fear about AI as well, right? It's going to take over our jobs. I mean, the phone, again, John said the phone is going to now take over and be smarter than us, all of that, right? But you have to look at it at the opportunity, you know, first. And, of course, we are a data company, so we're really trying to push the limits, you know, with data and what it can do in marketing as well. So we use and test AI extensively across marketing. And one of the most game-changing use cases for me, and I'm in B2B marketing, and nowhere in New York, so there are probably a lot of B2C folks here, but for us in B2B, it's all about building pipeline, right? That's what you do in marketing. And what's been game-changing using AI for is really predictive pipeline and forecasting. Most B2B marketers are always struggling with suddenly they're in a quarter and they don't have enough pipeline, right? And from a marketing perspective in B2B, there's nothing you can do in the quarter. Everyone in the campus trying to fix it and scramble, but it's sort of too late, right? In marketing in B2B, we build our pipeline 6 months, you know, from now. So that ability to really be able to forecast, you know, which territories are going to have enough pipeline and who doesn't, that really allows us to really reallocate our marketing resources to where they're going to have impact. Because marketing is always about really spending just as much, right? You don't want to overspend if you don't have to. You don't want to underspend either. So forecasting, of course, in B2C, things around churn, you know, retention. We're just going to get a lot of efficiency out of it. I think AI and Gen AI, it's really going to be marketing's best friend. So we have to look at it. That what is the? You have to be curious about this future best friend and what it can do for you.
And I'm going to get back to that notion of future best friend because I want to go down a different path. But first, let me ask you. So how are you? How is Nasdaq embracing disruptive technologies?
Yeah, I mean, I think that I probably have one of the best jobs that I've ever had. I've been at Google and NBC and Paramount, and everywhere that I've been, I've loved what I do. But we're so interesting in that we sit at the intersection of the capital markets. And we're arguably one of the most innovative and disruptive exchanges, and also have some of the most innovative and disruptive companies. So we really look B2B, and we look B2C. But from a, you know, embracing technology and embracing digital disruption, it's really looking at taking some of our most innovative and disruptive clients and thinking about what they're doing. So if you're looking, you know, at the beauty business and you're thinking about rethinking what your revenue is going to look like over the next 5 years, 10 years, looking at direct to customer, what are those technologies from mixed reality to AI to VR? You know, it's different in the, you said earlier, in TV streaming, right? If you look at media and you, so we have so much information, and it's, we're really in this privileged seat to be able to make some bets and say, these are the technologies that are going to really be important. AI obviously is one of them, generative AI, how we use it for both from, you know, from a customer perspective and then internally.
So you think it's Gen AI, you think? Is that?
I think it's Gen AI, but Gen AI is super interesting in that, you know, AI is something that isn't new. It's the way we've been thinking about it and using it. You know, I think when we spoke earlier, my dad did his PhD at Stanford in computer science in 1968, and it was computer science and AI. And he went to IBM and was on one of the founding teams of building Watson, and that was AI. So we're talking about AI. A year and a half ago, we were talking about NFTs. So I think it's, you know, I agree with you, Denise. I don't think generative AI is going anywhere. I think we're going to get smarter about how to use it, how to adopt it across all levels, what prompts to ask it, how to think about what the follow-ons from those are. So, yeah, definitely generative AI is all the rage. It's going to be everyone's best friend, but if we figure out how to use it.
You know, it's funny, I was at a conference last week that usually I see you at, the Empowered CMO event, and they were talking about whether or not generative AI is going to take over people's jobs, especially the marketer's job. And you said it's going to become the CMO's best friend.
But it's not going to take over entire jobs, right? It's going to take over parts of our jobs. And it's going to take over the parts of our jobs we don't like to do anyway.
Sure. True. Make you more efficient, so that way you can spend your time strategizing, yeah. Okay, next question. Let's look at it through another lens, and I'll start with you, Sehr. What do you think of some tech that's not taking off? So you said, you don't have to name the brands, because I know you're around a lot of brands and technology. So what is some tech that you're super excited about and maybe it's not taking off?
You know, I think it's not that it's not taking off. I think there's so much technology. We have so much technology that we actually don't really know how to use. Mm. I think sometimes if you look within big organizations, and Denise, I'm super interested what you think about this, but so many organizations that I've either worked with or for have hundreds of tools and technologies, and different groups use them sometimes, maybe, but it's not always connected. So sometimes I think when we talk about what technologies are taking off, it's really customer and consumer adoption. And like, where are consumers spending time? 10 years ago, we didn't have social influencers. We didn't have, you know, Instagram. We didn't have people. We had Instagram, but we didn't have the influencers who were, you know, making their livelihood not in places that exist today, right? So I don't think so much that it's that the technology isn't taking off. I think that we're not adopting certain technologies, and so as on a whole, and so, but a lot of it is very usable.
And then we had a customer advisory board yesterday, and someone used the term shelfware. So if you're not using it, it goes on the shelf. Mm-hmm. You figure out when to use it again. What about you, Denise?
No, but some cases, right, I suppose the products are too hard to use. Like Elisa talked about, right? There was no empathy really for the actual user of the technologies. That could, of course, be a reason. I think also in the case, you know, of AI, I mean, everyone now feels that pressure. I mean, the CEO is asking everyone, what's your AI strategy? What is your AI strategy? The board is pressuring, you know, the CEOs on this. But the thing is, you can't have an AI strategy if you don't have a data strategy first, right? Data is the main component of AI. It's like having a machine without the fuel, essentially. So you need to start at what is the data strategy for organization, then you can build, of course, your AI strategy on top of that. Another thing as well, and I think it was Lucy talked about this, is also bringing technologies, the technologies within the company and the business side together, right? Because a lot of technology sits somewhere and it doesn't really exactly solve the needs of the business, you know, side. So what's been really disruptive for us on my team and what we're seeing among many of our customers as well is that those who are really succeeding with data and AI now, they have data scientists on their teams, right, on the business side. In the past, they've always been more on the IT side. You have to go and knock on someone's door. They think they understood the problem you had, right? They go out and solve something, come back again, it becomes shelfware. So that, I think, it's going to be important to really have kind of the data scientists, you know, on the business side. And then there are, of course, you know, products like Contentsquare, who makes it really, really easy for the business to adopt these technologies as well. You got to really start building that competency out on the business side, on the marketing side.
Great, thank you.
What about you at Contentsquare? What are you seeing from a
I wasn't prepared for this.
From a disruption perspective, and then also the technologies that are taking off or not taking off.
Nothing different than what you've said. Yeah. I mean, it's AI. I remember when ChatGPT came out or was announced, Jonathan Cherkey brought me into his office. Hey, Nikki, come here. How are you using ChatGPT? Are you using it yet? How are we going to use it? I'm like, oh, let me figure this out.
I'm gonna, the email response, you're gonna look for the answer in ChatGPT and send it to me.
Exactly. But I mean, you know, it's funny you say that. I actually just did a prompt last week. I said, write a blog for Jonathan Cherkey, CEO of Contentsquare. And it pulled, I guess, things he's written in the past, and it was perfect.
Wait, that was the whole
prompt?
That
was my prompt, and I sent it to him. I'm like, look at this, and it wasn't even your head of comms, Sarah, who did it. It was ChatGPT, so super disruptive, but it's interesting, it's fascinating how it really got his voice, even some of the nuances that he says, some of the phrases.
Interesting.
And the most exciting part is when you're going to have ChatGPT on your own data, on your internal data. So, for instance, in B2B, you know, we have our all SDRs, right? They're doing the follow-up on the leads. Of course, in B2C, it's, of course, all the contact centers. But when they can, again, that immediate, most relevant answer in real time, that's going to be incredible.
Use it to be efficient, right? So, like, you mentioned SDRs or BDRs. Like, how do you use it to then enable them use the tech to do all the outbound, right? The emails and the subject lines are super catchy. And then your inside sales reps can be actually talking to people, engaging with people.
I mean, we always cringe, right, when we see those emails coming out from the SDRs. So this would be incredibly impactful when we finally have that for them as well.
Yeah.
How far away are we from icebreakers being what's your prompt?
I don't know. Your thoughts?
Tomorrow, maybe.
No, maybe. Yeah, that's a good idea. Maybe the next panel, that should be kind of the icebreaker. Okay, so we're all operating in a constant cycle of disruption. How can we get to a place where we're future-proofing rather than constantly reacting? I'll start with you, Denise.
No, I think if there was anything we learned in the last couple of years is that adaptability is the superpower of business today. So I think it comes back to future-proofing, can come back to culture of your organization. What is your relationship with the change? How do you handle that? Are you ready for that? I mean, how adaptable are you? So I think that's, it comes back to the culture, really, I think. Because we don't know. There is no real, true crystal ball, right, for everything. I mean, there's been so many curveballs, you know, thrown at us, and it comes back to that.
Thank you. Sehr?
Future-proofing is one of my favorite topics. I think the pace of change, to your point of how fast everything's changing, is we're in a place where innovation and disruption is not a solo act.
And you must see this all the time at Nasdaq. I mean,
all the time.
Yeah.
And what's super interesting is now, because of technology, we're at a place where, you know, 10, 15 years ago, innovation used to be incremental or a little bit peripheral. Here's your core business. What does peripheral innovation look like? I think we're sort of at the precipice of massive industry and corporation having to figure out how to collaborate. If you think about it, like the future of gas stations, as we have, you know, EV and roads that now have recharging devices on them, like the future of gas stations has nothing to do with gas. The future of farming has nothing to do with dirt. So many industries are so interconnected that future-proofing, I believe, is going to be so, it's going to be so reliant on collaboration across industry, across company. And so then it becomes, how do you think about your short-term returns? Mm-hmm. How do you think about delivering today, 18 months, 24 months, but then also not losing sight of what's happening 5 years out and being able to take a series or a ton of little bets that then become something that can actually drive long-term innovation?
And also when we talk to leaders of big organizations today, it's not that they are not confident that the technology is here. They all know that technology is here. They're not confident in their own ability to execute on this. Mm. So a big part is really around skill sets and development of the organizations.
So how do you do that? So how do you build those teams that are agile and...
Yeah, I mean, also, again, it comes from the top in terms of course, developing that kind of culture of, you know, adaptability. It needs to be a priority at the leadership level to implement those training programs, or you're probably going to have to go in and hire, you know, some skills that you don't have as well.
Any tips and tricks for people to get started? Like, if we go back to AI and they're trying to do it within marketing, since you run marketing at Snowflake.
No, but also then, do you have that culture of fear of anything new, or do you have a culture of, you know, curiosity? Do you actually encourage your organization to test these things, right? A lot of organizations right now are like, no, we're not going to touch this. This is dangerous. I mean, there are, you know, data privacy issues, all kind of things. But there are things that you can't do today that doesn't violate, you know, data privacy and those sort of things. It's more about foster that culture of, you know, for people to experiment with things.
I was at a Bloom Reach event, the Edge Summit, about a month ago. And Ali Miller King, this AI guru, if you guys don't follow Ali Miller King, you need to. She's amazing. She worked for Watson, and she's always advising on AI. She said where you should start is by asking your teams, like in Slack or something, like who's interested, first of all. Once you get some people who are interested, just doing some pilots, like pilot-proof scale. But when you do pilot it, make sure you check with your legal counsel, because there's so much that, like, we don't know yet, and you don't want to make mistakes the hard way. So, pilot-proof scale. You know, get some people in your teams who want to try it, and then extend it to the rest. All righty. So let's hear your predictions. We have 4 minutes left. In your view, what is the next big digital disruption, and what do brands need to do to get ready for it?
I think John mentioned it also here this morning. I mean, hyper-personalization is going to be the big trend, you know, for brands. It's going to be all about delivering the right content at the right time to the right people, and that has always been the challenge in marketing, because marketing is always about relevance and it's about timing. And before the days we had data, you know, we couldn't do that. And now we have more data than we've ever had, and we're going to have even more. And we're going to have tools and products like Contentsquare that is going to help us, you know, do this. So I'm really super excited about the future of marketing and opportunities for brands to really take advantage, you know, of this. I think it's really the best time ever to be marketing at this this time. But also in order to then how to do this. And also what we see, it comes back to the leadership at the top of the organization. And I think one of the best examples is when Angela Ahrendts came in as a CEO of Burberry in 2006. Mm-hmm. And she said, you know, Burberry is going to become the most digital brand on the planet. That was a North Star for the organization. She brought everyone with her. And it became, you know, one of the most digital first luxury brands, yeah, you know, in the world. But again, it was a CEO driving this. And I know at Nasdaq, right, you know, your CEO is incredibly data driven, you know, as well. But you cannot just hire a CDO and hope that the CDO is going to fix something, right? It needs to be a priority at the highest level of the organization.
Is that what Adina did? She hired you and thought you could fix everything?
Oh, gosh. No.
So what's your prediction?
She's fixing everything. I agree. I think that there's no divide anymore between digital. It's so integrated into our lives. And so I agree completely, the personalization, customization. I think, though, that we're really going to have to figure out how to streamline an in real life and digital experience, and how to connect the feeling of in person, the feeling of what happens, you know, to your example about Angela Ahrendts, like luxury has been an industry that's been so hard to get that feeling of, you know, luxury, mm-hmm, in digital. And she was, you know, at the end of the day, I think you have people who shape culture who are always going to find a way to shift industry. Hopefully we have many more who are, you know, to your point, starting with the top and, you know, really shifting how we think about things. But I do think that that's what we're going to start to see next, is that divide, or that the divide close between, like, how you can actually have a in real life experience, the ones that are bucket list, the ones you can't, yeah, buy, the things that, you know, like where you feel things. How do you do that in digital? How do you leverage AI, generative AI? How do you leverage all of these things to connect it?
And Contentsquare, that's what we try to do, right? Because yesterday, someone at the cab goes, one of my favorite words that you guys came up with is rage clicking, right? You're like, there's always someone behind that mouse trying to do something, right? Are they awestruck or dumbstruck? Are they elated or frustrated, right? And at Contentsquare, we try to help our customers understand that, right? Tie it to the emotion. So, all righty, we have 38 seconds, so I guess we should close here. So if you take away anything from this today, you need to think like Sehr and Denise. They're innovators, they're trailblazers, they're trying new things. And this, you know, technology is not going away, obviously. It's just getting faster and faster and faster, like Denise was talking about. There is no crystal ball. All you need is great teams, technology, and great leadership. So a huge thank you to you, Sehr and Denise, and round of applause.